I would say probably one of the most misunderstood mortgage programs on the market today are secondary homes. Because people are like, what is that? Is that like my house? Is it like a rental property? What is that? Okay. And so yeah, I think it's probably the best kept secret, because you can, you know, it's a great way of helping yourself up with a whole bunch of functions, which we'll look at today. So to clear up by definition what a secondary home is and what it is not. So it is a non-primary residence. Obviously, we're talking about Canada. Everything we talk about is in Canada. I can't finance a property in France, which I could, but I can't from Canada. So we're talking about Canadian residences, okay? And so it is a non-primary residence, so it's not the one you're always living in, okay? But it is owner-occupied or occupied by an immediate family member. Immediate family member is parents, legal guardians, siblings, or, yeah, spouse, okay? So no other people. So it can't be my cousin or my uncle. That's not a it's not a secondary home. And so you will unpack a little bit what that means. So it's not the home that you're living in permanently, but nobody else is occupying it either. So a good example maybe is a cottage, okay? So in other words, I live in where I live in the GTA or somewhere in Ontario, and I have a cottage somewhere, and I go to that in the summer or wherever I go to it. But in the meantime, nobody else is living in it. It stands empty. That is a classic example of a secondary home, okay? The next one is, and this is probably something that a lot of people haven't thought about, is what's called, you know, secondary home, but my kids go to university. I live in Toronto. They can go to University of Guelph, but I don't want to pay for res for them, and I'm going to let them live in the place. It can be a condo. It can be anything else, okay? That's also a good example of a secondary home. Another example is a home for a frail family member. I got a client, for argument's sake, a daughter has got an illness, and she cannot look after herself. So the client's saying to me, why should I be paying $2,000 rent and I don't own the property? Let me rather buy a condo and pay the mortgage, and at least I own the equity in that property, all right? So that is a good example of a secondary home as well. Or a parent who's frail, who needs care, and you want to buy the home next door so you can just walk across. They can still have the independence, but you want to walk across and take care of them. That's also a good example of a secondary home. And then this is a great one for business people. And it's basically, you know, one of my clients actually contacted me on Facebook and say, I live in Toronto, but I work a lot in Windsor, and I'm kind of sick and tired of paying hotel bills and et cetera, et cetera. I would much rather live in my own house and be, you know, save myself some money and also be more comfortable. That is a great way of owning a secondary home as well. Now, it doesn't have to mean that you have to travel that far. For, let's just say somebody lives in Oakville, and they go to meetings sometimes late at night, and they want to buy themselves a condo in downtown Toronto to live in if they have to sleep over or something like that. That's also an example of a secondary home. So one thing also to remember under the secondary home program is you don't have to justify it. It just has to make sense. So you don't have to say, like, wait a second, like, I go to work, you know, 10 times a month, and now therefore. No, if it passes the logic test, then it is a secondary home, if it obviously meets the criteria of the program as well. Great. Hopefully helpful to you so far. Now, secondary homes are divided into two categories. So a type A secondary home meets the following requirements, okay? First of all, maximum one unit. That's really important. So you can't go buy a duplex and say, well, you know, I'll rent out the other unit. That is not allowed. It has to be a zoned single family property. Okay. So in other words, none of it can be rented out. The moment that is there a component that if an appraiser goes in and says, okay, oh, there's a second unit and it's a basement, but it's rented out, they will not finance it. Okay. Again, as I said, it's gotta pass the sniff test, so to speak. All right. And it's got to be on permanent foundation. Now, I mean, there's no condo in Toronto or anything, or a home in a suburb that's on a non-permanent foundation. Right? Again, you can see that's got more to do with a cottage, all right? and it's got to be zone residential, rural, or seasonal. We'll talk about that a little bit in a moment, okay? Now, here's kind of a weird clause, but it's it is a real one. So the property must be at least a kitchen, a three-piece bathroom, a bedroom, and a common area, okay? That's kind of, you know, if you look at principal residences, it's kind of the same thing on condos too, all right? And the next one is it must have year-round access serviced by a local municipality or a private road with a service contract in place. So now I can have a cottage, as long as it's plowed all, you know, throughout the winter, all year access. But my friend Joe, I've got a written contract and he plows that every day for me. He lives up there. That's quite acceptable. No problems. Okay. And it must have a permanent heat source in it. So a stove is not a permanent heat source. A electrical baseboard heaters, that is a permanent heat source. Or a heat pump, that is a permanent heat source in it as well, okay? It must be on, the water source must be a well, municipal water cistern, or river or lake water, as long as it's on a permanent filtration system, all right? So, you know, just kind of a, if I may for a second, we live in a, you know, strange world these days. Obviously, there's no ways I can unpack every single minutia about everything, about every possibility of a secondary home. So I'm giving you a, not quite a 10,000 feet view, but a bit lower. But there's obviously some things that I cannot, you know, cover here today, all right? So, and then the property must have electrical power. In some cases they will accept energy sources like solar, stuff like that, but it's on a case-by-case basis. And important as well, it must be in a good and marketable area. That's important. I mean, if you're going to go way back and none of it and there's no electricity, that's not a type A cottage, okay? That's important. Hey, listen, Nadia and my team have done some great work. If you scan here, you can actually do it now. It's going to take you, no, don't do it now. Then you're going to get distracted. So you can go here then, and she's got some great free goodies there for you. In fact, some of the stuff she's got, she's developing for you, are really awesome. You can put in the hours that you may travel. It'll tell you how much time you're spending traveling and how much you can save by buying a secondary home. And there's also a checklist what make a property a A or a B property. So checklist you can download for you as well, all right? Okay, so let's look at mortgage requirements for a type A secondary home. Now remember, I'm dealing with insured or insurable mortgage requirements. So you're like, what is that error? Okay. Basically, anything with less than 20%, less than 25 year amortization, anything more than 25 years is not covered here. Okay. And the property's got to be lower than less than $1 million. Okay. That is covered in here. And we call those insured and insurable. All right. So maximum one vacation property per applicant. They don't want you to own one in Vancouver and one in Toronto and one. I get it, but they kind of, it's starting to smell like a rental portfolio. Okay, so that's why they kind of, the rules stop that. The property's got to be less than $1 million. That's a pretty nice cottage for sure. And this is important. So Metro Toronto, Metro Calgary, Metro Vancouver, maximum mortgage, not purchase price. Mortgage is less than 750,000. The rest of Canada, so now it's if you're buying a cottage and you want to buy for 999 purchase price, you're going to have to put $400,000 down or close to $400,000 to get a mortgage of 600, because it won't go under under these rules, insured, insurable. So then what about properties that are over $1 million, okay? I'm not covering it in this webinar. The reason why I don't is because the sky is the limit. From there on, because of the new mortgage rule, every lender can make its own rules and it can be ultra conservative or okay, but it's not as good as these programs. I can tell you that much. They will require a lot more down payment from somebody. All right. And the minimum down payment, this is really key. A lot of people don't understand. You can actually buy a cottage, right? If you're buying for $500,000 or below, yep, you heard me right, 5% down payment. That's it. You don't need 20% or 35%. Any of that stuff's not true. It has the same down payment requirements as a principal residence. Okay, so which means below $500,000 in purchase price, we need 5% down payment. If the purchase price is below $1 million, and above 500,000, then it's 5% of the first 500,000 and 10% of the rest of the money below $1 million. Okay. If that hurts your head, I know I'm not trying to turn this into a math contest. Okay. But if you have any questions just about that, just message me. I'll try and help. And again, maximum amortization is 25 years and traditionally and fully verifiable income requirements. So meaning you cannot just, you know, oh, I've got, you know, bank statements that are enough. No, it is the normal, original, traditional way of proving income, pay stubs, employment letter, notice of assessments, et cetera, et cetera. Now, this is also cool. Obviously, it has to be approved and everything, but you are allowed to add purchase plus improvements. So in other words, if you buy a cottage and it's $450,000 and, you know, the bathroom is looking pretty tired or the kitchen is tired, we can add up to $40,000 to the mortgage to do those improvements for you. Obviously, there's rules and terms and conditions attached to it, but it's a great program of taking a maybe a tired looking cottage and or a tired looking secondary home and turn it into a nice property. Okay. Important here is no third party guarantor. So when you buy a principal residence, mom and dad can step in and say, okay, we won't live there, but we'll help qualify. You can't do that, right? Also, what's not on yours, you cannot be new to Canada. You have to have established credit, a regular Canadian, etc., etc. And you can even your down payment can even be gifted here, which is pretty amazing, all right? So a lot of people are like, how come I didn't know about this? It's a really, really great program. And there's the QR code you can scan again to get those free goodies we talked about earlier, all right? So let's talk about a type B secondary home, all right? And it's Ontario, so there's, I don't know if there are any other people from other provinces, it's probably applicable to a lot of provinces too as well. So maximum one unit, again, the same thing. This is the same as before. Now, here's the difference. A type A cottage has to be on a permanent foundation. A type B cottage can be on stilts or on blocks, okay? That's pretty cool. And it must be zoned residential, rural, or seasonal, just like the other properties. Now, here's key. The road can be seasonal. In other words, it doesn't have to be plowed in the wintertime. That's a type B cottage, okay? Again, it's very, as I said, this is very applicable to cottages because, you know, in Toronto, any city, the road's going to be plowed, all right? And the property may be accessible by boat, unless if you're buying a cottage on an island, that is a type B cottage, all right? And it does not have to have a permanent heat source. So for argument's sake, it can have a wood stove or a fireplace. That would be considered fine for a type B secondary home. Now, this is a pretty crazy clause. The water does not need to be drinkable, but there must be running water in the home. All right, so that's important. And then for sewage, the holding tanks will be considered if it's common for the area and it meets municipal or provincial requirements, right? And then the area must also be marketable. In other words, there must be other real estate that sells and stuff like that. Lenders always look for, if something happens, can I sell this property and how fast can I sell this property? That's what they do, all right? So, I mean, I didn't even say this. This is the last week of the summer, and so it's a pretty good time from this point onwards to look for cottages because guess what's going to happen? Cottage season is kind of coming to an end slowly but surely, and so you may even see a bunch of properties going on the market because people are like, yeah, you know what? I'm probably done with the cottage thing or whatever else, so it's a good opportunity. The other thing that's coming on is obviously kids are going to university and mom and dad have to start to pay those residential or res fees. And so that's a good way as well. Parents are obviously with kids going to school, they're making career changes. So there may be, you know, opportunity to look at that as well from a traveling point of view. So good season two for us to talk about this. All right. So here's a few nuances that you need to be aware of when it comes to type B secondary homes, right? And again, maximum one vacation property, below $1 million. Here is the big difference. The mortgage amount cannot be more than a $350,000 amount, okay? So you can see that the risk with a type B is reflected in the maximum loan amount that they'll give. The other thing very important is the down payment, a minimum, no matter what the circumstances are, is 10%, okay? And in this case, gifts and borrowed down payments are not allowed. So you pretty much got to come to the table, all right? Now, for secondary homes, on the type A side, you pretty much have the same credit requirement, a few nuances, same credit requirements than you'd have for a principal residence. For a type B secondary home, you need to have a Beacon score. All applicants must have a 680 Beacon score, all right? Sorry, I forgot to say maximum 25-year amortization as well. And they do allow purchase plus improvements as well, all right? And no third-party guarantors allowed. So what is ineligible? So rental or rental pool properties. This is, to be frank with you, this is a massive source of fraud. There's a lot of people say it's a secondary home, but they are using it as a rental property. And I mean, that's been a hotbed. We almost lost this program because of the amount of fraud committed through it. So the banks are all over it. So the question you have in your mind then, well, when can I ever rent this out? And this is always up to an individual lender's terms and conditions, okay? Nobody wants to ever stick their neck out and say, oh, you can rent it out after 6 months, a year. I know of one lender that says you can rent it out after a year, but it really is up to the terms and conditions of the mortgage lender who lends the money, okay? Mixed use properties are not acceptable. That mixed use means you've got a residential unit on top and you've got a commercial unit at the bottom, okay? That's not acceptable. Timeshare, how I wish it was, but it's not applicable, doesn't apply to that. And co-op properties also are not covered by this because co-op is just very legally difficult to tie down, all right? So those are not eligible under the secondary home program, all right? So let's look at some benefits of secondary homes. Obviously, memories. I mean, there are people, you know, I've been in Canada for 20 years, but the amount of people who, you know, kind of third or second generation Canadians will tell me that, man, my memories were built on the cottage. And now it's going to be really good memories to fight the Highway 400 up north, but it's still worth it. So, but there's so many people who've built incredible memories up north. I'm sitting in Oakville, so it's a great way of building memories. And then it makes your business travel much, much, much more bearable, all right? And then the kind of obvious one is you increase your net worth. Now you've got, if you're used to going on holiday or you traveling, at least you buy a property and you're actually increasing your net worth. So it's a great way of doing it as well. And significant cost savings for children. I know of a few clients who bought their a condo for the kids to live in for university. University was done. They sell it and they take the profits and they make, instead of making a loss from the children going to university, now they've actually made a profit for the kids going to university from, obviously not from the education, but from the actual accommodation that they would have had to pay, all right? And then this is a big one for a lot of people. Instead of mom having to, or dad having to live in a home, they can live next door and they can be, you know, still autonomous, but you know, they can be close for close attention, right? Close by. So that's a really good benefit to have. And then here, I mean, this is incredible. Probably of all of them, that's probably the best, is you can own another property with less than 20% down. Now, I'm not condoning, you know, buying secondary homes and renting out. And that's what I'm saying. But the bottom line is, you can, if you're buying a secondary home for less than $500,000, you can buy a second home for less than 20% down. That is pretty cool to have. So these are some of the benefits. I'm sure you could think of other ones as well. If you have, I'd love you to share them in the, in the chat in a moment. I'd love you to actually share some things in there as well. Some of the benefits if you know of any, okay? So as is tradition, I always run a little bit of numbers for you because I want to show you a little bit of what's possible. So I'm taking Bruce and Mary, nothing stereotypical about that. And I said, okay, Bruce is earning $75,000 and Mary earns $75,000 and they are the perfect Canadians. They have AAA credit and they have no debt whatsoever, okay? So together they earn $150,000 and I said that Bruce and Mary own a semi. And their mortgage is $442,000. They have a 25-year amortization. By the way, I picked these numbers randomly. There's absolutely no reason why I picked those, okay? And I just said 5-year fixed, and that's their mortgage payments and their property taxes and all the good stuff. And I go, okay, what if Bruce and Mary then go and they buy themselves a secondary home type A for $400,000. Okay. Well, they only need 5% down, which is pretty cool. And obviously, then you have to pay the insurance. 4% is the insurance rate. That's not the mortgage rate, okay? That's the CMHC mortgage, insurance rate. And then the mortgage becomes $395,200. 25-year amortization is the maximum we can go to. 5-year term, and the payment would be $1,807.97. So that's something great for you to remember. What we also do, very important for you to know, is that if you give us your documents, we will actually pre-qualify you so you know right up front what you qualify for. So there's no surprises with us. You're not going to go, oh, my goodness, I didn't know I couldn't afford that or something like that. We will do all of it for you up front. What I'm going through here is 2 pages amongst a few others that you'll get. So you'll know exactly what it's going to look like for you to purchase, okay? And you can see no debt again here. And the maximum we can go to on the TDSR total debt service ratio is 44%, and you can see we're below. So Bruce and Mary, if they earn that much in income, they can buy themselves a cottage for $400,000 or a secondary home, and they would qualify. So that's pretty neat. Now, if you bought a $400,000 cottage, then you are gonna you're gonna have to pay closing costs, right? So for that approximate is $1,856 closing costs. You're going to have to pay the PST to the government on the mortgage insurance, that's CMHC insurance, and you're going to pay the Ontario land transfer taxes and title insurance. So your closing costs are going to come up to approximately $7,897. Your down payment, $20,000. The total funds you have to have is just short of $30,000, and you can buy yourself a secondary home for $400,000. Hopefully that gives you hope and gives you some options you can think about. As I said, if you want us to run some numbers for you, then obviously in this case, obviously I'm taking a big chance here because I don't know what Bruce and Mary's credit is, and that's a major pillar in the mortgage process. So I definitely want to do that to give you numbers. All right, that's pretty much it from me to you. I thank you so much for taking the time to join me here and to listen to me ramble on about things that I'm passionate about, helping you primarily. But thank you very much. Have yourself an awesome evening, and we'll see you on the other side of the next webinar.